All right, everybody. So first off, welcome to Beantown, which you've already been welcome to several times, but it doesn't hurt to do it again. So if you're in this room, you're very lucky in that you've had the privilege to learn swing dancing at a time when one of the great masters is still alive and kicking. And if you were actually in one of the groups, you were also lucky enough to even have Norma Miller herself give you some choreography. So apparently this morning in one of the groups, they were dancing and Norma was watching and they were going through the choreography and Norma said, no, wait, don't do that. Do this instead. And I think it all turned out for the best. Is that correct?
Thank you, Norma.
So some of you are lucky enough to say that you got choreographed by Norma Miller today. And Norma Miller is not just incredible for her dancing prowess, which, as you can see in films like Hell's a Poppin' and Day at the Races, was clearly very good. She also is amazing for us to have around because she was such an incredible chronologer. I really should have looked up that word before I started talking to you guys. But basically,
historian.
Thank you. An incredible historian. She captured so well her life growing up in swing dancing and then her life in showbiz in her fantastic book, Swing Into Savoy. I highly recommend that you get it if you don't have a copy. In the past, we've done these, I guess we call them video interviews, where we show a video and we have Norma talk about it. And we've done that about her great dance routines, like Day at the Races and Hell's a Poppin'. This time, no Hell's a Poppin', no Day at the Races. We're going to stick to Harlem, the world that the swing dance grew up in. We're going to stick to the Savoy Ballroom, where she learned how to dance and perfected her steps. And we're going to stick to things that were happening around that time that helped grow the dance that we know today. So ladies and gentlemen, please welcome to the stage the incredible, the fabulous, Miss Norma Miller.
Because it matches the garment.
How do I get up here?
With help.
All right, so hopefully we're going to.
I can see.
Okay, excellent. We're going to put that right there.
Okay, good deal. Hello. Thank you so much. This is so wonderful, and I'm so delighted to be on the stage to share it with this wonderful gentleman named Bobby White. He is one of the newcomers to this type of entertainment, to be able to be a monologist, to explain to you what we are doing here in places like this. This was a great story because at one time it died, completely, it died. And it was someone who was dear to me who gave it mouth-to-mouth resuscitation. And that was the beginning of why we are here. And welcome, please, the wonderful Bobby White.
All right, so we're going to put on the screen. This is some footage of Harlem. And I think Norma even knows almost the exact years, if I'm not mistaken. So feel free, Norma, to talk about what you're seeing up there on the screen as it happens.
That's Harlem. This looks like it's 125th Street or one of the avenues. And if you notice, in Harlem in those days, when they went out, they was always dressed up. Look at the outfits. And I think this would be, is that a street? That might be Lenox Avenue, or that might, let me see, 7th Avenue. That's a, that is now called Adam Clayton Powell Avenue, I think. They're changing the names to different people who lived in that area. See, if you notice how the people are dressed up, look. Right, look at this. Who know plush fours? And you know he don't play no golf. And you notice the chicks are wearing, they were called stone martens, you know, pieces of foxes. That was the type of thing you wore in Harlem. Because in Harlem was always a dress parade. And that was a very important time. I was standing outside of the Savoy Ballroom on an Easter Sunday because I wanted to see how the women went into the ballroom dressed. Because if I wanted to, if you want to see an Easter parade, you're coming out of the winter and you're putting on what they call spring fair. And brother, going into Harlem at the Savoy Ballroom was the best dressed people. And that was what I was standing out there watching. Those people go into the ballroom, and a man by the name of Twistmouth George invited me to come into the ballroom at 4 o'clock in the afternoon to dance with him. And that was how I went into the Savoy Ballroom the first time, and I was 12 years old.
So they show the gentleman getting, going to a hair barber, and now they're getting a
barber shop
and stuff. Is that common?
That was Black Man's Country Club. That's, they're getting that process on their hair called conk. This must be Marcus Garvey Day, because it looks like a parade. Is this 7th Avenue, Bobby?
I'm not quite sure.
Cotton Club. Now, the Cotton Club was 2 blocks down from the Savoy Ballroom. And black people was allowed to work there, but you couldn't go there and go into the club at all. That was the days of where it was strictly catered to white patrons, black entertainers, white patrons. That was the Cotton Club prior to them moving it down to, I think, in the 50s somewhere, because they wanted to change white people's spending habits. So they knew if they had to do that, they had to get rid of the Cotton Club that was 2 blocks down from the Savoy Ballroom. So you notice you got white patrons, but black patrons was not in the audiences of the Cotton Club. Now this is Clarence Robinson, Dancing Girls. This is the chorus line. I think you get a glimpse of Clarence Robinson in this shot, I think, somewhere. But he produced the shows at the Cotton Club. And if you notice, all the girls in the Cotton Club was a certain shade. You had to be 3 times lighter than I am to appear on the stage at the Cotton Club. There was only one dark girl ever in that lineup, and that girl was called Lucille Armstrong. She was married to Louis Armstrong. She was the only dark girl that was ever in this lineup. See? All the girls are a certain shade. Yeah. Well, sweetie, believe me, prejudices was part of everything we did in America. Remember, we were born into racism. Racism was a part of everything we did. And that was what made us so different. It was the persons, we were the great entertainers, but we were not allowed to come into the front door. I don't think I went into the front door of anything until I was about 70 years old, because I only knew how to go in the back door. And that was acceptable. Could you believe that?
But one place you could get in was the Savoy, is that correct?
Well, the Savoy was the one place in the world, that opened its doors to all races. It was a black ballroom. And remember, in those days, Harlem was a place where white people came to have fun. And it was taken over by white people. So here a place was opened, and it allowed black people for once to go in the front door. And that was 1926, and that was the Savoy Ballroom.
We're gonna take a small snippet from Kim Burns' jazz, where Frankie Manning's gonna talk about the Savoy. And at the end of it, you actually get to see some dancing, some Lindy Hop in the Savoy in the late 30s.
Anybody who was anybody in Harlem wanted to go to the Savoy, to hear Chick Webb, to try to forget the depression, to dance to the brand new sound.
And our one ambition was to go to the Savoy Ballroom. And I remember it was six of us. And we were walking up these steps, and as we were climbing up the steps, I could hear this music coming down the stairway. We were walking up there, and we started, oh man, you hear that music? Wow! And we walked through the door, we opened the door, and we turned around. As you come up the steps, when you come through the door, your back is to the bandstand. So you turn around the stairwell, and then you face the band. And as I turned around, the floor was full with people. It looked like everyone on the floor was doing the Lindy Hop.
That was when he had hair.
Yeah. So as Norma pointed out, Frankie Manning is one of the dancers in that scene. We'll watch it a few more times so you can see him.
You see him, yeah. And also Billy and Millie, they were the second year Harvest Moon Ball Lindy Hop champions, 1936. Yeah. I'll show you. There he is right there. There's Frankie.
You can see that telltale smile.
Isn't that wonderful? Actually, this is what we did every day of our lives. We danced on that dance floor because it was the one place where we found freedom. And we could do what we want to. And that was what began. There you are. That's Frankie. And he even had a mustache. Wow, look at that. But without a doubt, one of the best dancers on the dance floor. That was Frankie Manning.
So I'm gonna keep playing this clip over and over because so many people had so many great questions about dancing at the Savoy, and I think this clip might help people see it. So first off, is this an accurate representation of what a regular night at the Savoy was? Like, is this the kind of dancing that you would see them do?
Yes.
So I think some people are like, oh, well, if there were cameras there, were they dancing differently for the cameras, or is this pretty much the way it would have gone?
That's how they, listen, you had the great Chick Webb on the bandstand. You was uninhibited. You danced what you heard, and that was what, this is typical of any time on the dance floor.
And so we also have people dressed up.
And you notice how they're not only, some people are doing the walk. Some people, that's Billy Williams right back there, the one that won the second year Harvest Moon Ball. Now you notice the walk, the guy that's walking back, that was a dance that was called the walk. I renamed that the swing walk. That was a dance you did as a verse, as a tone to Lindy. Sometimes you didn't want to just Lindy, and you just did a one step around the ballroom. And this was what we did at the end of the night. We would do the walk, and everybody in the ballroom would be doing that dance.
So, what did the...
There we go. Now, here the guy comes. See him walking? Now, that is the dance we did at the end of every night at the ballroom. And Frankie and I were two of the leading opponents of this dance, because it alleviated you from continually doing the lending. And that was the result of that. Now you notice there's another couple close together, dancing cheek to cheek.
That couple that just moved across the screen right there?
Well, you had a variety. You had a place where you could come and dance whatever time you want to dance. You can take a fast tone and you can break it in half. When you da 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 da, or you can da 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 da. So you do what you chose. No one dictated to you what you would do on that floor. Okay?
So how loud was the band compared to like the band, you know, compared to last night when you heard Jonathan Stout? How loud was the band in the Savoy?
They didn't need electronics. You didn't, Chick Webb, you could hear him from, you could hear Chick Webb from the ballroom into my bedroom at home. Because there was no air conditioning. Windows was wide open. I lived in back of the Savoy. Because I can sit on a fire escape and watch the people dance, and I could hear the band come into my bedroom. My mother used to cuss these bands out and said, shut up that loud noise. She said it in much more colorful speech. And that was every night. Bands would be blasting into our house. But what a wonderful way to learn how to dance. And that's how I learned how to do the Lindy.
You mentioned at the end of the night, how late was the night at the Savoy for you? How late would you dance?
4 o'clock in the morning.
4 o'clock, and was that like the music was done at that point? They closed the doors?
4 o'clock, they played the last song. Okay. So that you knew it. There was a song they played at the end of the night. It was a song you knew that place was closing. Like the man said, you don't have to go home, but you got to get the hell out of here. And this was a time, but this was the only place we had. This is where you congregated. This is where you met people. This is where you became, Adam Clayton Powell was there as many nights as I was. This was where a man by the name of Dan Burley used to write a newspaper. And they got all their information here. This was the community. Savoy was our community. And we met and could discuss what the hell is white people doing again now. So
this here is a floor plan of the Savoy. Just so you can see what was going on. So this is the entrance.
Right.
That Frankie was talking about, where you come in and then you turn around and you go up.
You go upstairs first. You go upstairs. Now, when you go upstairs, you go into a panel of doors. You walk in these doors and you turn around. And now, for the first time, you will see the bandstand. You heard the bandstand. You heard the band when you were coming up the stairs. And we have over here, we have hostesses sitting down. If a gentleman comes in by himself, we're not talking about hookers. We're talking about hostesses. But there's a difference, of course. But if a gentleman comes in and he don't have a partner, he can go and buy a ticket and give it to the lady, and the lady will get up and dance with him. That was so that gentlemen who were by themselves was not left out. Savoy had a policy. Ladies free night. That was the night that ladies could come in free because they know for sure the dudes was gonna come. Have you ever watched the Jack and Jill? Yes. You know the Jack and Jill, the workshop? Yeah. That's speed dating. Change partners. What's your number? Who'd you? And that's how it began. He and she touched, and you had a choice as they brought went by. I dig this one. No, this one ain't got enough. No. Has it changed? I saw speed dating this afternoon. And here come the guys looking, and they look. It don't take but a minute. And if the broad got what he's looking for, you can bet he's gonna make the right moves.
I was amazed when I first saw this, how thin the dance floor was compared to the rest of the building, right? There's a whole lot of building and only a little bit of dance floor comparatively.
The dance floor was a block long. It was inside. You know, like the ballroom stretch, like from, say, the exit. You see where they see exit? That's the ballroom at the end. Now you're coming from the exit to where the beginning of the stage is. Now you got this is all ballroom.
Gotcha.
All ballroom. Now on the back, further back from this curtain, you got the bandstand.
Right.
But you have all of this area to dance, and you got a block long.
And it was long and thin.
Long,
right?
And thin.
Which is why they call it the track.
And on the other side of it were the boxes or loges where people could sit and they could watch the dancers on the floor.
You can see that all in the...
Right, that's where the movie stars would come and watch us dance every night. And we danced every night.
So here in the modern era, you know, we'll do a shim sham throughout the night. Was it common in the Savoy that people just like start doing a shim sham sometimes?
We never did the shim sham at the Savoy Ballroom.
Oh.
The Savoy Ballroom was created by Leonard Reed.
The shim sham was created by Leonard Reed, right?
Yes. The shim sham was a tap routine that Leonard Reed and his partner Willie Bryant did as an encore to their act. We never did the shim sham at the Savoy. There were no line dancing at the Savoy. The only pair dancing.
And so at one point you guys started, the Whitey's Lindy Hoppers specifically would perform a Big Apple, is that correct?
Whitey's Lindy Hoppers became a name because of a lady by the name of Ethel Waters. We was in her show. She came to the Savoy because she was taking a show on the road. Ethel Waters was a major Broadway star. And she was one of the first stars to come to the ballroom specifically to learn how to do the Lindy. She wanted it in her show. And she met with Whitey at the Savoy Ballroom. The results of their conversation, he turned her over to Frankie. Frankie was the only person allowed to dance with Ethel Waters. And that was how we got to do the finale in her show. And because we were an act and she was paying us, she named us Whitey's Lindy Hoppers. And that was when we became Whitey's Lindy Hoppers, because of Ethel Waters. Question?
So,
go ahead.
So you guys had did you have contests at the Savoy, right? Like a weekly contest at some point?
Every Saturday.
Every Saturday night?
That was the contest that was strictly for the ballroom patrons. And Frankie and I was always in contention against each other who would win that contest. I wanted a winter coat one year, and I think I paid $2 a week at Klein's to buy the coat, and I had to win 10 contests to buy a coat.
But you got the coat, didn't you? Here's a little footage of, we do have footage of the Whiteys performing Big Apple and doing what appears to be a contest at the Savoy.
Yeah.
Norma can correct us if we're wrong about this.
This is the Big Apple, and we're in the first Harvest Moon Ball. See, this is the competition to pick who is going to the garden.
Oh, so it's the qualifying round.
There's Leon James leading the parade. This was a part of the performances that we held in the ballroom. See, you notice he's got a number on his back. And that was the first time we had a contest where we were judged from outside judges. It had nothing to do with the people in the ballroom. And that began, we were competing in the harvest moon ball, who would go to the garden? And that's what this is.
So I noticed here that some of these guys are wearing really nice suits, and then they're wearing some sneakers.
Well, we didn't wear sneakers then.
Okay.
Sneakers was not in. What, see, that's that white suit.
Oh, there's some white bucks, right?
That's that white suit Leon James won the contest in. Yeah, right. See, you know the snake, go ahead. This is Chick Webb's, I think that's Roy Eldridge on trumpet.
All right, so you see how we have some...
This is like Thompson Wilder. But this is what the part of the contest that was leading up eventually to who would win. It was every Saturday night, and sometimes I won, sometimes Frankie won. We were competing, but we always competed. I was always second or third, and you would be surprised. Did I buy that coat from that money? Yes, I did.
So, but you will say that your generation was the first to stop wearing the long skirts and the heels, is that correct?
Well, the long skirts, we had them up to date at the races. Have you noticed they're at the races? We had skirts down. But when we did Hell's a Poppin', we cut the skirts off and they became here. Because now we're doing aerials. So it was difficult to do aerials in skirts, but the mode of the day was, I think they call those maxis, I think that when your skirt was down here. But all women wore that wardrobe at the time.
But there were, like for instance, the Shorty George's dancers and stuff, they wouldn't wear sneakers, is that right?
Oh no, they didn't wear sneakers at all. They hated us. Yeah. They called us, they thought we were, see, Shorty Snowden was the first of the elite to create a dance with the band. That was Shorty Snowden. Now, they had a group that was Shorty and B, a Stretch, Leroy and Little B, Madeline and Freddie, that's a brother and sister. Now, that was a trio. They were the first black act to go with a white band. They went with Paul Whiteley. Now, Whitey was trying to book Lindy Hopping for the first time, but Whitey and Shorty were on the same level. So Shorty said, I don't need you. I mean, I don't need you to book me, I can book myself. So Whitey said, okay, then I'm going to look for my own dancers. Hence, he looked for young dancers, and Frankie and I were two of the young dancers that was picked. Then he, of course, in time, pitted Shorty against Frankie. Now, Shorty is of another era. Frankie is a young 18, 19-year-old. You're coming up against the master. But what happens? Youth take over. Frankie just wiped his ass off the stage. Nobody at that time could ever come up against Frankie. I mean, he was like nothing you'll ever see before. Frankie was the best with the best, but he created our generation. So all the generation that came with Frankie, they the ones that did the dance like this, and they were over, they bent over. Yeah. And all that, you notice, all the dancers with Frankie had a crouch. Where Shorty and them was straight up. Well, now the music is changing. Well, who knew the music better than Frankie? Frankie would pick a tune. We say, "Hey, what is he?" Frankie played, and we followed Frankie whatever he did, because Frankie was the best of the best. Frankie would take a chick. You see that exit? He would be dancing, and he would say he's going to take her there. And he could do it in two swings. If you watch Hell's a Poppin', and you watch how Frankie cut across a stage, that was what his power was. He had upper power strength, and then he had a girl with him. We called her Raggedy Ann, because she was like this. So he'd throw her, and with one leg, she never took her eyes off Frankie. She looked at it, and if you watch Helter Poppin, you'll see it. They were perfect. You don't get partners like that. He didn't have to ask. He could throw her anywhere. If you notice, there's a picture where she's up in the air, coming down. One leg is up. That was Frankie, man. They were perfect.
Speaking of Frankie, he talks about how at the Savoy Ballroom, for him, at the very beginning when he was learning, women would not dance with him until he could show that he was...
That was not in the Savoy.
No?
That was at the Renaissance.
Oh, okay.
When we were kids, we went to the Renaissance because that was the only place where young dancers could go on a Sunday, and we would dance from 3 o'clock in the afternoon till 9 o'clock at night. And this is where me and Frankie started. That's where the first time I saw Frankie was at the Renaissance. Now, we were the kids, the upcomers. None of us have ever been in the ballroom, the Savoy. But that's where we started. And they might have said it in the Renaissance, but nobody refused him at the Savoy. No, he was the best dancer, period. Could I have a glass of water? I'm fainting.
Certainly, sir.
Go ahead.
I'll be right back. I'm going to get some water.
So thank you. Please. But it was a... Okay, wait a minute. A bottle? Sorry.
I'll put that right here.
Stuff don't go down as easy as it used to. I tell you, getting old ain't easy. Oh, God. And see, I'm 90. I wear out easily. But I'm here to deliver a very important message. Keep your ass swinging, because it don't mean a thing if it ain't got that swing. Okay, I'm ready.
Oh, we did have a really interesting question that I wanted to throw at you. Was the Lindy Hop, when you first started, was the Lindy Hop just the name of a step, or was it the name of the entire dance that you were doing?
I think Shorty wanted a name. Somebody asked him a question. What is this dance that you're doing? And because of Lindbergh's Hop was in the papers, Lindy's Hop, he said, I called the dance the Lindy Hop. It was not something that was thought of. Right. I think he was just looking for a name, because all they were doing in those days were a two-step and a swing out. So that became what we know today as the Lindy Hop. And that was Shorty Snowden.
And so when you first said, oh, I want to learn Lindy Hop, you meant, oh, I want to learn that dance with all the different figures.
No, I used to sit out and look through the window. And remember, this is the time the music is changing. The music is coming in, and remember, dance respond to music. We came from chuka 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 two, dum 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 dum. And you know, you did that kind of a movement. Now they're smoothing out the music to be da 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 da. Now you're moving that way. That is the beginning of what eventually became known as swing music. Why? Because they put papers in front of a musician, the saxophone, the trumpet. They're beginning to blend. And when you blend the music, you began to blend the step. And that's what eventually became known as swing dancing, because the music changed and we had the bands to play it. They came to the Savoy to play this kind of music, and you had arrangers that would be bringing arrangements in to try out. So all day long, bands will be rehearsing. Out of that came the greatest bands in the world. Mainly the King of Swing for us, Chick Webb. The decision was made 1938 when they decided, John Hammond, to bring a white band into this area. No one had ever heard of this before. Benny Goodman is coming to the Savoy. And if you can't believe what went on, you think we was voting for president. You mean a white man taking on the king? And if you notice, there's a clip that Frankie is describing that night. Do you have that clip? Where he's describing what happened when Chick Webb and Benny Goodman met.
No, I don't have that clip on this computer.
You mean you don't have that clip?
I do, but not with me here on this computer.
Anyway, Frankie is describing this night, and no one described it better, because here was somebody coming in, the best of the white bands. I mean, Benny Goodman was swinging his ass off, and he come up against Chick Webb, who was swinging his ass off. So the argument between me and John Hammond, who would win? Well, I don't think Chick Webb won because he kept changing the tempos. I say, yeah, Chick Webb kept changing the tempos to make sure he'll kick Benny Goodman's ass out of the ballroom. And that was that night, 1938, the greatest night ever of a battle of the bands. But what was so wonderful, you see, a band would be playing, and their last number that they'd be playing, the band coming up would sit there and join them on that last number. So the music never stopped. This band would be going off, and this band would be, you couldn't believe this night. We never stopped dancing. I was exhausted. But did we have a king? I don't know. Shortly after, we were at the Paramount Theater, and Chick passed away. So Benny Goodman became King of Swing. Now, did he become King of Swing because he was a white band? Or did he become King of Swing because he was the best band? The question, I leave it to you. It's never been answered.
All right, so we know that the Savoy Ballroom had the dances that we've been talking about. I want to ask really quickly about rent parties, because there's an aspect of dancing that we don't, that we haven't been able to see because
it's
not on clips.
I started in this business in rent parties. My mother used to give parties, it's called house rent parties, to pay the rent. My mother was an immigrant to this country. My mother found herself in a position where, in those days, immigrants couldn't get jobs. My mother had my sister and I was born 1919. My father died November 1919. I was born December 1919. So I've never had a father. And my mother had to support us in whichever way she could. And that began the house rent parties. Well, I was a dancer. I was the star of the house rent parties. I used to entertain the guests for a bowl of ice cream. Cheap labor. And that's how that started. I started in this business as a dancer in house rent parties. That's when my mother found out I could dance. So what my mother used to do in those days, every theater in Harlem had amateur night. This was a night they gave out dishes one night or something, but an amateur could come on stage and maybe win $2 or $3. So my mother put me in these amateur nights. I played every theater in Harlem, the Odeon, the Lafayette, the Roosevelt, $2, $3. That's how I started dancing. Not good, maybe, but I won some. I didn't win some. That is how the dancing began. This was strictly Charleston. And that was the dance we did in those days. Charleston, and I was a great Charleston dancer. Period.
So we had some footage of some of this blues style dancing that I think a lot of people will say, oh, well, was this what was going on in rent parties? So maybe you can give us a little bit.
No, what was going on in rent parties was bumping and grinding.
All right, so this is...
What do you think? You didn't think they were doing anything legitimate. They were drinking cheap liquor and getting a free screw. There you go. Sorry, ladies, but that's the way it was.
So this is similar to the kind of dancing you would see at a rent party.
Well, of course. Only thing, the lights was down dim and the music was slow. And it was called a free screw.
Well, that was a cool... And the Savoy Ballroom...
There you go. This was legit. But this was how this came about. He and she together. And it was called a dry one. A dry screw.
There you have it.
You see? They are adopting what began in the dark rooms in the apartments to a piano player. There we go. He's got a dip. There you go. Who the hell is that? That looked like Esther Washington.
Yeah.
That's Mildred.
Yes.
That's Mildred Pollard.
Yeah.
Yeah. That was the bumping and grinding period. They did a lot of bumping and grinding, and that's how they got away with it. It's called being screwed by the fickle finger of fate. Which means you got the screw and you just didn't get the jollies.
You know, the lighting you mentioned reminded me of a different question. In the Savoy Ballroom, how light was it in the dancing? Were the lights down low? Were they up high in the Savoy Ballroom? Like when Chick was on the thing?
Well, you can always get in the corner and be in the shadows. Well, you didn't think it was all a Chick, did you? Listen, he and she meet, he got ulterior motives. He's thinking, how am I going to do it? And she's thinking, how am I going to get away with it? That never, never changes. Y'all suckers is still trying to seduce us. But that's what part of life is, seduction. That wonderful feeling, I'm gonna get this bastard right now. But it's a wonderful seduction. It's been a long time, I'm just talking from memory. I started in this business, and you know, you had to send out resumes. My resume said, healthy, sexist, single. At the end of my lifetime, my resume said, healthy, sexless, single. I wasn't exactly a nun. I just live a nun's life. None of this, none of that.
All right, I think we have time for one more clip. So this is a little bit of dancing with Norma and three very special leaders.
Right now, you know what?
I have my seat.
And still my partner. I think my partner Billy Ripper's in the house. Where's Billy Ripper? Come on stage, Billy Ripper. My partner for 30 years. Where is he?
We were together 30 years. Never arguing.
They were dance partners for 30 years.
Wow.
Al Mintz.
Al Mintz.
here.
Oh,
and
wow.
I tell you, Ed Sullivan had to take us all into the Lowly State. So this is the group that went down to Rio.
Where did you get this?
So right now, we're going to switch
oh,
the
God.
Remember, I can't keep up like I used to. So I don't expect a whole lot.
Watch this.
That's Billy Ricker, who is her partner in Hell's a Poppin'.
Now me and Al is dancing.
That's Al Mintz, who is the third leader in Hell's a Poppin'.
Exactly.
And of course,
let me and Frankie. I want Frankie to bend back. Watch this. So when we get to Rio de Janeiro, we open on the 5th of December. And on the 7th of December, Pearl Harbor hit. Boy, I tell you, all hell broke loose. Now, for the first time, we're out of the country. And we are in a war in our country. We don't even know where Pearl Harbor is. First time we heard it, said, where the hell is Pearl Harbor? We didn't even know what it was. But that was the time when you had a draft, and they drafted the men, and they took all of our dancers in the army, and that's what changed everything. And it's to what we have today. Everything was changed because now we don't have dance partners. So what do the three girls do? I don't know what they did, but I formed the Norma Miller Dancers. That was a younger crew of dancers. They never did the Lindy Hop, but they were jazz dancers. And out of that group came Frankie Manning's son, Chaz Young. And that was the story of Norma Miller Dancers. To Norma Miller and the Jazz Men, period. To where I am now, sitting here with Bobby White.
All right, so we've gone from Harlem, we've seen the Savoy Ballroom, we've visited rent parties pretty strongly. And now we've seen you dance with some of the greatest Lindy Hoppers of all time. Is there anything else you want to leave us with, to take with us about dancing, about swing dancing?
Dancing is a wonderful release. It allows you to be free for the first time in your life. And if you have someone that you're close to, dancing cheek to cheek, you can't get no closer than that. And you can feel the body, you can feel the heart pumping. And you love that person. It's a marvelous feeling, even if it is for a second. Because it ain't gonna be long before that sucker gonna dump you. Boy, have I been dumped. So what happened? I thought this was the thrill of a lifetime. It never lasts, for God's sakes, it doesn't last. But it's wonderful when it happens. The joy of dancing is we have great camaraderie. We have one thing in common. We love to dance with someone. It beats dancing with a broom or something. So grab somebody, fall in love, screw or don't screw, it don't matter. Screwing a very
important. You guys are getting this.
Listen. You're gonna get screwed. We were born to be screwed. So take it or leave it. Life is good at any way you take it, but keep on swinging.
See you later. Ladies and gentlemen, Norma Miller, telling us what it was like. Make sure to get her book, Swing and Savoy, if you don't have it, it is an essential reading.